Tonight, a man who claims to have killed Philippine broadcaster Percy Lapid surrenders to police and confesses to the crime.
But the family of the slain journalist is skeptical of the suspect's claims.
Dozens of cases of the XBB Omicron COVID subvariant are detected in the Philippines.
And Russia targets power and water facilities across Ukraine.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Tia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, Philippine police have in their custody a man who confessed to the October 3rd murder of broadcaster Percy Lapid. The alleged gunman claims he and several other accomplices had acted on orders from someone inside the National Penitentiary. George Carino has tonight's top story.
Interior and Local Government Secretary Benhur Abalos presented to media Tuesday morning the alleged gunman in the ambush lay of journalist Percy Lapid. Abalos says the self-confessed gunman, identified as Joel Estorial, voluntarily surrendered to authorities. Estorial claims he's now fearing for his life.
Sumuko ka na naman, gawa ka ng affidavit. Ano masasabi mo sa press ngayon sa nangyaring ito? Bakit mo na gawa yun?
Kasi po, lumabas na po yung mukha ko sa TV po. Natakot po ako. Tsaka nakonsensya po sa paggawa kaya Percy Lapid po.
The secretary also showed photos of Estorial's two alleged accomplices, identified as brothers Israel and Edmond Dimakulangan. According to Estorial, six people were involved in the assassination. Estorial also says the order came from someone inside the New Bilibid prisons, but he didn't give specifics.
Sino nag-utos sa'yo?
Galing po sa loob, sir. Sa Bilibid po. Kasi po, sir, yung ano namin po doon usapan, kung sino po ang matapat doon sa kay Percy po, siya po ang babaril. May nagkataon po natapat sa akin. Sabi naman po, pag hindi ko binaril, ako po ang papatayin. Kaya na binaril ko na po si Percy.
Estorial says they were promised 550,000 pesos in exchange for the hit job.
Anim kayo, 550,000 ang binayad.
Opo.
Okay? So may natanggap ka bang pera pagkatapos?
Opo. Inulog po sa bank account ko po.
So magkano napunta sa'yo?
Is 140 po, sir.
Secretary Abalos says Estorial turned himself in along with the gun allegedly used to kill Percy Lapid. The secretary rejects allegations. Estorial is merely a fall guy.
Ang tanong ng publiko, totoo ba yung sumuko na yan or is he just a fall guy? Hindi niya lang inamin because the gun itself would match the slug. Nag-match yung ballistics, number one. Number two, yung mga damit na pinunit-punit niya. Nandun pa rin talagang damit niya po ito. Number three, yan po ay nasa CCTV.
Abalos did not offer more details of Estorial's surrender nor his testimony. But the Interior Secretary gave assurances questions will be entertained once investigators secure additional evidence or arrest other suspects. The Secretary maintains they do not want to compromise ongoing police operations and investigation. At least one senator says he will seek an investigation on the claim someone inside the New Bilibid prison ordered the veteran broadcaster killed. George Carino, ABS-CBN News.
The self-confessed gunman in this assassination of broadcaster Percy Lapid is told by police to reenact the murder at the crime scene in Las Piñas City. The walkthrough had been requested by the slain broadcaster's brother, who remains skeptical about the alleged killer's confession. This report from Jack Batalyones.
Sana po mapatawad po ako nila. Hindi ko naman kagustuhan yun.
The family of slain journalist Percival Mabasa, more popularly known as Percy Lapid, wants authorities to conduct a reenactment of the ambush slay of their kin. Percy's brother Roy Mabasa says their family is unconvinced. The self-confessed gunman Joel Estorial is the man who fatally shot the veteran broadcaster.
Hindi po ako kumbinsido. Nais kong magkaroon ng matching kung ba pwede dun sa video footages at saka itong tao. Sana ibigyan ako ng pagkakataon na makaharap ko.
Roy claims the PNP already had the suspect as early as Friday. The Mabasa family is challenging the PNP and interior and local government to prove Estoliera isn't just a fall guy.
Unang request natin sa kanila ay kung pwedeng padaanan sa walkthrough itong sa scene of the crime itong suspect at ibahagi sa atin, ilarawan sa atin kung paano nila isinagawa ang madugong pagpatay sa aking kapatid.
Roy is also calling on the PNP and the Bureau of Corrections to immediately secure the individual who allegedly ordered the hit.
Madali nang sabihin na itong nagutos ay patay na. So that means pag sinabing patay na yung nagutos, sarado na itong kasong ito.
The Southern Police District for its part says they are still validating Estorial's confession.
Lahat nga po na sinabi nitong ating sumuko suspect ay subject for ano po yan, pag-aaral at validation po.
Jack Batallones, ABS-CBN News. Philippine prison authorities vow to ascertain whether someone from inside the national penitentiary had indeed ordered the killing of broadcaster Percy Lapid. But the Bureau of Corrections says it has put in place policies which aim to prevent convicted criminals from inflicting further harm to society. The Bureau spokesperson admits no inmate should still be able to communicate with cohorts outside of prison to commit criminal acts. The Philippine Justice Secretary says an investigation should verify whether the plot to kill Lapid was a conspiracy hatched inside the national penitentiary.
Sa loob ng bilibid, kung sino man yan, dapat malaman natin. Ilalabas natin yan. We have to know. The charges have to be filed. The conviction has to ensue. If it's going to be a plea of guilty, it has to be vetted properly. The testimony has to be has to come out so that there will be a basis for the police to act on this matter later on. Because definitely a gunman is not the whole crime itself. It has to be vetted as a whole conspiracy probably.
The Philippine Justice Secretary dismisses calls for his resignation following his son's arrest on drug charges. Secretary Jesus Remulla vows to stay put despite concerns he might influence the outcome of his son's case. Mike Navalio has this story.
He will not step down from office. This assertion from Justice Secretary Jesus Crispin Boying Remulla as he faced the media for his first press conference after arriving from Geneva, Switzerland, and since the arrest of his son on drug charges last week. Juanito Jose Remulla III is facing a charge of illegal possession of drugs before a Las Piñas court after receiving a package with almost a kilo of kush or high-grade marijuana, estimated to be worth 1.25 million pesos in his house in Las Piñas on October 11. He is also set to undergo preliminary investigation before the Pasay City Prosecutor's Office for the complaint on importation of illegal drugs. But for Remulla, leaving his office is not his choice to make.
It will not happen. It's the president's call. And if I feel later on that I am not any more effective in this position, then I will talk to the president about whatever has to be done in the future.
Remulla said he has talked to the president, who had earlier expressed his support for the embattled secretary.
He just said that he commiserates with my plight as a parent. That's all. And he said that just go back to work because we need you.
Remulla said he has yet to talk to his 38-year-old son, and he refused to comment if he intends to visit him. He earlier said he will not intervene in his son's case.
I haven't talked to him actually since the beginning. I've stayed away from the case. I just talked to a cousin of mine who's a lawyer, who will start or has started representing him already.
The Justice Chief also vowed not to talk to Prosecutor General Benedicto Malcontento, who heads the National Prosecution Service. And his advice to his son's lawyer?
If there is a resolution, do not let it reach the DOJ. Let it be discussed in court, whatever the case may be. If it's it's an adverse case against my son, it will not be appealed here. It will go straight to the courts for trial.
In the midst of various criticisms and calls to resign, Remulla said his family is holding very well and he will not allow himself to be affected. Both the drug possession case and the illegal drugs importation rap are non-bailable and carry a penalty of life imprisonment if the younger Remulla is proven guilty in court. Mike Navallo, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine President Marcos Jr. vows to defend the peso from weakening further while using interest rate adjustments to combat inflation. My colleague Pia Gutierrez has this report.
Reining in inflation remains the number one priority of the administration. This assurance coming from President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. as Filipinos continue to reel from rising costs of basic goods, including food and fuel. A Pulse Asia survey released in October showed 42% of Filipinos were not satisfied with the Marcos administration's performance in controlling inflation, which has emerged as the top urgent national concern of Filipinos. But Marcos in his tweet said, the Philippines is doing better than other countries. Socioeconomic Planning Secretary Arsenio Balisacan says the conflict between Russia and Ukraine, as well as recent typhoons that devastated several agricultural areas in the Philippines, will continue to affect the country's economic outlook.
Our analysis shows that sustained increases in inflation in 2022 and 2023 will cause a slowdown in our economic growth, translating into a GDP level lower by 0.6% in 2023 than its expected level had there been no sustained inflation shock.
To mitigate the effects of rising inflation, Balisacan says government plans to continue with assistance programs to the most vulnerable sectors, such as cash subsidies for the poor, as well as farmers, fisherfolk, and public utility drivers.
As we do seek for solutions to the short-term challenges, we are very careful that we do not compromise our medium-term goals, which is to put the economy to a higher growth trajectory so that we can achieve more jobs, high-quality jobs, and reduce poverty rapidly.
Balisacan says government continues to lay the groundwork for faster and more inclusive economic growth to generate more jobs and reduce poverty. The new Omicron XBB subvariant that's driving up COVID cases in Singapore has been detected in the Philippines. The Philippine Health Department reported 81 cases of the subvariant, 70 of which were tagged as recovered. 8 are still in isolation. The status of the other cases is still being verified. Health officials also logged 193 cases of a new variant known as XBC. The variant is believed to be a recombinant of the Delta and BA.2 variants. Despite the emergence of these new threats, the Health Department believes there's no need to tighten border restrictions just yet.
Tayo po ay may safeguards na sa ngayon because our population are vaccinated. Pangalawa, yung behavior ng pagsusuot ng mask ay naandyan na sa ating mga kababayan. Pangatlo, siyempre, handa ang ating sistema kung sakasakaling tataas ang mga kaso. So hindi po tayo pwedeng nagbubukas at nagsasara, ng ating mga borders ngayong panahon at sitwasyon natin ngayon, 2 years after or going through this pandemic. Kailangan, we should all live with the virus at marunong tayo na mag-adapt kung ano man ang sitwasyon.
The Philippines on Tuesday recorded more than 1,000 new COVID cases with 34 new COVID-related deaths. The positivity rate from October 16 to 17 is at 13.8%.
Next in the news, several regions in Ukraine now without power after Russian attacks hit critical energy facilities.
More stories when the World Tonight returns.
We'll be right back. We're back on the world tonight. Russian missiles hit power and water facilities across Ukraine on Tuesday. Two explosions caused serious damage to an energy facility in the southeastern city of Dnipro. The attacks disrupted water and power supply to several regions, including the capital, Kyiv. Ukraine President Volodymyr Zelensky says a third of his country's power stations have already been destroyed by Russia. Meanwhile, Ukraine swaps more than 100 female prisoners with Russia. It's the first such exchange in the nearly eight-month-long war. The Russian Defense Ministry says majority of those turned over to them were crew of civilian ships held by Ukraine since February.
At least 13 people were killed when a Russian fighter jet on a training flight crashed into a residential building in the western city of Yeysk. The plane's engines were believed to have failed during takeoff. The two pilots ejected before the plane hit the nine-story building. It is unclear whether the pilots were unhurt. Russian President Vladimir Putin ordered authorities to provide all necessary assistance to the crash victims. British Prime Minister Liz Truss apologizes for her mistakes that roiled financial markets and caused investor confidence to evaporate. But the embattled premier told the BBC she would not step down.
What I'm focused on is delivering for the British public. Now, I recognise we have made mistakes. I'm sorry for those mistakes, but I've fixed the mistakes. I've appointed a new chancellor. We have restored economic stability and fiscal discipline. And what I now want to do is go on and deliver for the public.
Truss endured a tough day in politics after the last of her tax-cutting plans was thrown out by her newly appointed finance minister, Jeremy Hunt, raising questions about who was actually in charge.
Mr. Speaker, what is she left with? No authority, no credibility, no plan for growth, and it is clear to see the people who caused the chaos cannot be the people to fix the chaos. Yeah. They are out of ideas, out of touch, and out of time.
The British government expresses concern over the assault of a Hong Kong pro-democracy protester at the Chinese consulate in Manchester. The victim was reportedly injured when a group of men dragged him into the consulate while he was taking part in a peaceful demonstration. An investigation is now underway. China's foreign ministry has denied knowledge of the incident. It insists China's embassies and consulates in Britain have always followed the law.
Trade unions in France launched a nationwide strike. Tuesday's protests disrupted public transport in schools in Paris and in other cities. The demonstrations are taking place amid the highest inflation recorded by France in decades. It also comes amid fuel shortages caused by a series of work stoppages at major oil depots. Oil refinery workers are seeking a resumption of negotiations with the government for better wages and working conditions.
The U.S. intends to increase its presence in the South China Sea as part of Washington's efforts to secure the Indo-Pacific region. This pronouncement made Tuesday by U.S. Homeland Security Secretary Alejandro Mayorkas, who also touted Washington's $60 million investment in maritime initiatives for the region. Mayorkas spoke to Asia-Pacific reporters via teleconference from Singapore, where he is attending a cybersecurity summit. Mayorkas says the U.S. Coast Guard, a military service attached to his agency, is ready to deploy assets at the request of countries for maritime training as well as for security cooperation.
We are, for the U.S. Coast Guard, rapidly deploying assets and additional personnel through the region to help meet partners' requests for maritime training, capacity building, and other ways in which we can most closely support and work with our partners in the region.
Japanese gaming tycoon Kazuo Okada is arrested in the Philippines on grave coercion charges. Okada was nabbed Monday upon arriving from Japan at the Ninoy Aquino International Airport. He has since posted bail of 12,000 pesos. Tiger Resort Leisure and Entertainment, which operates Okada Manila, earlier sued the billionaire over a hostile takeover of the resort casino in May. Universal Entertainment, which owns Tiger Resort Asia, says two Parañaque City courts issued arrest warrants for Okada last week. Okada's camp says he returned to the Philippines to face the cases. Several other business partners of Okada are also facing charges for grave coercion over the takeover.
Philippine shares were the biggest winners in Asia on Tuesday as the main index gained over 150 points. The details in this report.
Asian shares were in positive territory Tuesday as investors cheered strong earnings on Wall Street and a major policy reversal in the UK. Sentiment in the region also further boosted by International Monetary Fund's positive comments on Asia. In its latest outlook report, the IMF said Southeast Asia remains a bright spot even as the global economy looks set to head into recession next year. Philippine shares were the biggest winners in Asia. The PSE index gaining over 150 points to climb back above the 6,100 level. Value turnover was at around 4 billion pesos. An analyst says the PSE index is seeing a relief rally because there's too much money on the sidelines.
Well, you know, there is such a thing as what you call too bearish, no, in the market. And when things become too bearish, like in the last few days, wherein you can see the value turnover already dropped to like 3 to 4 billion a day.
In company news, SM Prime opens its 80th mall located in Tanza, Cavite. The building is set to serve shoppers in the northwestern areas of Cavite and nearby areas in Batangas. Meanwhile, the Philippine Central Bank has also partnered with SM Supermalls to boost their push for cashless payments. The central bank has urged Filipinos to go digital in paying for items and services. Over at the spot market, the peso closed at 58.75 to the dollar, stronger than Monday's close of 59 to the greenback.
Philippine police returned to the crime scene where veteran media man Percy Mabasa was shot dead on October 3rd. The walkthrough was held in Las Piñas City late Tuesday with a self-confessed gunman, Joel Estorial. The authorities were accompanied by Mabasa's brother, Roy, who earlier requested the police reenactment. Further details on the reenactment were not immediately available. Our final word tonight is a quote from Arthur Baer. "It is impossible to tell where the law stops and justice begins."
And that is The World Tonight, the 18th of October, 2022. I'm Tia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez. From the Philippines, thank you. Mabuhay!